You're watching Canadian Muslim News on Muslim Network TV from Toronto, Ontario. I'm Sami Sayed. Welcome to the show. Now, coming up, we have an interview with Sister Sobia, the co-chair of the Anti-Racism Coalition of Newfoundland and Labrador. But first, let's take a look at the headlines. Government appoints Indigenous special interlocutor for residential schools. Suspect in Ontario mosque attack charged with terrorism. New book captures Manitoba's rich religious diversity. Traffic lights in Baghdad resume 19 years after U.S. invasion. And now the details. The Minister of Justice, David Lametti, has announced the appointment of a special interlocutor, Kimberly Murray, to manage the government's response to unmarked child graves on former residential school sites. For the next 2 years, Murray, a Mohawk woman originally from Kanesatage, Quebec, will recommend laws and practices for the federal government. She will work with Indigenous communities and organizations to protect and preserve the gravesites. Murray is the former executive director of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission of Canada and was Ontario's first Assistant Deputy Attorney General for Aboriginal Justice. The suspect accused of attacking worshippers in an Ontario mosque is being charged with 7 counts of terrorism. 24-year-old Mohamed Moise Omar faces charges of assault with a weapon and uttering threats to cause death or bodily harm, among others. In March, the suspect attacked congregants during morning prayers with bear spray. He also had a hatchet and knives with him. If the suspect is found guilty, his court case and terrorism-related charges allows prosecutors the possibility to argue for tougher sentences. The mosque's imam says, and I quote, "I hope today will be the first step towards justice." Two Winnipeg artists showcase Manitoba's rich diversity of religious communities in their new book, A World of Faith and Spirituality. The 213-page book features hundreds of photos of sacred spaces and includes essays and personal reflections from a variety of faith groups. Ray Dirk and Manju Loda have been working on the book for 10 years. Loda's goal is to reflect Manitoba's cultural and religious diversity, including and beyond Christianity, Islam, and Judaism. She and Dirk collected their material from various communities, such as Muslim newcomers in the southern town of Altona and Indigenous people in the Saguin First Nation. Traffic lights are set to function in the Iraqi capital Baghdad once again after a 19-year suspension following the U.S. invasion. Most traffic lights on some streets of Baghdad have been destroyed because of the chaos and violence caused by the U.S. invasion of Iraq in 2003. Some bullet-scarred traffic lights still show signs of the damages caused during the occupation period. Last week, Iraqi Prime Minister Mustafa al-Kadhimi ordered traffic lights to be reactivated. The head of the Iraq Traffic Department told Anadolu Agency that just over half of the total intersections in Baghdad have functioning lights. All others are broken down. That's it for the news. Only 2 weeks ago, a video circulating online showed a hijab-wearing teenager being called racial profanities, and she was hit by a stranger. To speak to us about this today is Dr. Sobia Shaikh, an assistant professor at Memorial University at Newfoundland and St. John's. She is also the co-chair of the Anti-Racism Coalition, Newfoundland and Labrador. Welcome, Dr. Sobia, and thank you so much for being here today.
Thank you so much for having me.
Dr. Sobia, what was your first reaction when you heard about this incident?
I was really worried for the girls. Actually, there was 3 girls who were assaulted verbally and one who was assaulted physically in this incident. So I was really concerned about the girls. I actually had a call from a community member telling us about this, telling me about this and asking if we could support. So I was shocked, disappointed, and really worried for these girls.
Mm-hmm. Are incidents like this common in the province?
I mean, certainly we're hearing a lot of incidents that are not being publicized. So we're hearing about them through the back door and in the community itself. So yes, there's a large rising hate crimes or hate racially motivated crimes that we're hearing about, and particularly Islamophobic incidents.
And even though we're hearing about all these incidents informally through our community networks, why are we not hearing them publicized as much?
Well, that's a really good question. I think one of the reasons is that There is a little bit of fear that there will be victim blaming, people who have been victimized by this, and we're seeing that actually happen in these cases. There's a little lack of trust as well in the police services to actually call something racially motivated. It seems to be really a resistance here in the province, in Newfoundland and Labrador in particular, where other provinces, I think, have been more forward in naming incidents as racially profiling or as Islamophobic. It hasn't happened here as much in the province.
And I'll touch on that topic later on, but I want to pick up on something that you said to the CBC previously about this incident. You said that incidents of hate are becoming, quote, normalized. Can you expand on that for me?
Well, I think they're becoming commonplace to hear about, especially in our circles. I mean, our circles, we get to hear these from community members. There's an idea that Muslim folks, racialized folks, migrants should expect these kinds of things. There's this kind of even though there's a lot of outrage in this case particularly, which was really hopeful. There's a lot of racialized people, Muslim folks, migrant folks, they know that this kind of thing is happening in the province. They're experiencing it.
And how has the COVID-19 pandemic added or even affected that?
Well, I think two things happened at the COVID time at the pandemic. First of all, there was a rise in anti-Asian hate. And people who are racist, white supremacist, or Islamophobes, they don't care about the color of your skin or whether you're really Asian or not. So we saw that happening at the early in the pandemic, which has come through. But the other thing we saw was George Floyd's the anti-Black racism coming up really forwardly in across the globe, and that's affected people's willingness to talk about it, which is really, again, something from the anti-racism coalition's perspective, an excellent thing that we can't, if we don't talk about it, we can do nothing to address it.
You said that this incident involving the three girls was picked up by the community, by the media, and has had its effect. What is that effect that you're saying?
I mean, there has been a lot of support for the family individually, which we really, we, you know, the I think the Instagram post had like, you know, thousands of actual hits on it. People saying, especially Muslim women saying, "Good for you." That's been really good. There's been an outpouring of people saying this should not happen in our province. So there's been some really good elements of this incident, not the incident itself, of course, but the actual support that the Muslim community and racialized communities are experiencing.
Now we've seen Newfoundland and Labrador's provincial government publicly condemn Islamophobia and hate, but these efforts seem to be centered around motions of solidarity and commemoration, rarely any legislative actions. What is the province doing to prevent such attacks, whether it's with the legislation or training?
Truthfully, nothing. I mean, I think that there's been some attempts to do cross-cultural communication in the government itself, but that by itself is not going to be enough. I mean, there have been such little attempts to do much work. I have, you know, the ministerial committee that you referenced, it was a first step, but it's a step that's really behind the rest of Canada in terms of dealing with this. So we would like to see more action. We have seen acts of solidarity against acts of Islamophobia from the government in moments, certainly in relation to Islamophobia, interestingly. And those acts are significant. Those acts are significant, but they will not get at the white supremacy that's here in the province itself.
And the committee you were referring to is the Ministerial Committee on Anti-Racism, and they had previously announced an anti-Islamophobia public education campaign. But you're saying this is not enough. What more are you looking for?
They haven't done much in terms of anti-Islamophobia. They haven't actually done it. We had a report that came out in 2019 called the Addressing Islamophobia and NL Community Report. We have three recommendations in there, and none of them have been actualized. And there's been a real reluctance of this government to actually do anything in terms of legislative change. And even with this announcement, there's been, you know, a serious lack of communication with the groups that are on the ground working with Muslims, with racialized communities to combat racism and Islamophobia.
Mm-hmm. And where is that reluctance coming from? Why is the government being so reluctant to implement these recommendations?
I think at first they hoped it wasn't a problem. I think that they thought if they put their heads in the sand, and I'm a little bit critical because I'm a little bit frustrated. So we've been at this work for 5 years. And at first they thought that by putting their heads in the sand, it would go away. There's this idea that Newfoundland is a welcoming place compared to the rest of the Canada, perhaps, you know, in relation to the whole world. And so there's this, there's a reluctance to see oneself as acting in any exclusionary ways. And we've seen that across Canada, but Newfoundland has a particular layer of kindness and welcoming that is really, you know, has truths to it, but also does not have, from the experiences we're hearing on the ground, it's not true that there is no racism here in the province.
Mm-hmm. So far there has been no proposal for any legislative action?
No.
Mm-hmm. Now, I know that you are also the co-lead for Addressing Islamophobia in Newfoundland project. Can you tell us a little bit more about the project?
Well, the project was came up actually in response to the Quebec shooting in 2017. We realized, although there was the support and you know, embracing the Muslim community in the aftermath of that particular event, we realized that there was no concerted effort against Islamophobia here in the province. So we launched this project. It was a community university project. It was funded by Memorial University's public engagement funds. And it was a year and a half to 2.5 year project, which culminated in an excellent conference hosted by MUN and the Addressing Islamophobia project, which included the National Council of Canadian Muslims. And it was really an exciting conference. We put out a report, and since then we've been responding to Islamophobic hate in healthcare, in everyday, in crime, in other places where it shows up. So it's been a very responsive community project, which is mm-hmm. persisting. We thought it was going to end in 2 years, and it hasn't.
Mm-hmm. So if I can take away anything from this interview or meeting today, it's that Newfoundland certainly has its work to do when it comes to Islamophobia.
Absolutely. And I think there's a lot of people who are ready to do that.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Well, unfortunately, that's all the time we have for today. Thank you so much, Dr. Sobia, for joining us and telling us more about the province. It was a pleasure to have you here.
Thank you so much.
You are watching Canadian Muslim News on Muslim Network TV. That's it from our Toronto studios tonight. Make sure to like, share, and subscribe to our channel for more Canadian Muslim content. Stay safe until next time.